So, the present use experiments we made with Grégoire Henry while working on the oxygen project, because we found that some things were too complicated to do, and many things were needed to be done in CAMEL before, the same kind of things that just Gen Suite does. And we think that it's not the right way to present something to programmers and are not core CAMEL programmers. But for instance, if you want to show that to Python programmers, it would be far too complicated. So some way to simplify that kind of thing is to do generic programming. So many of our ideas are shamelessly taken from Alan Frisch. And so if you want to see how we did that, it is on this blog. So everybody at some time got lazy and didn't want to write that. And just want to let the compiler do the work for you and do some generic function that shows what to do when you give him the parameters and he finds the types. So, one way to do that is to do that like Haskellers do with type classes. It would be nice to have type classes, but I think it would be far too heavy to implement in the current OCaml compiler. So we wanted to try something that is as light as possible, so the patch is light, to have maybe a possible integration if someone finds it useful. And so, one possible idea is to add a new environment to the compiler, which is not indexed by names like when you declare variables, but by types. So you add to the environment values, the compiler infers its type, and sometime later you use the other construction that tell find me that, a value that matches that type and put it here in my code. The actual syntax we have now that will change, don't start the flame war on the syntax, is that. So we declare that when you are declaring a value like f here, you can annotate it with an implicit keyword telling f now is in the implicit environment. Later, when you want to take that value, you use the val of type construction and you give it a type. And at compile time, exactly that that construction, it's like using the name of the value. It's exactly the same thing. It replaces the value directly here. So notice that you don't have to give explicitly the type at that point. The compiler knows how to type things. Use the inference to help us find the values. For instance, in the first case, you see that the val of type is used and applied to an integer. So with that, the compiler knows that it is a function. And it is a function taking an integer. Then the output is concatenated to a string. So the output is a string. Then we can infer completely the type of the function. Since we have the complete type, we can know which function it is, since it is in the environment. And we can replace it with string of it. And it does that result. But if you don't give the compiler enough information, for instance, in the second case, when you don't do anything with the result of the application, well, the compiler can't know what is the result. And if there is no information, it can't find the right function to use, since there may be multiple functions that can unify with that type. And we don't want the semantic of your code to change when you change what is declared before. So, if we go back to the example of the beginning, we have something that comes quite close to to solving what we wanted. If we do, if we write exactly what is at the bottom, we write exactly the same thing for integer and for float values. It's not as light as what we wanted, but it's generic. Just so the toString function is not really interesting. It just applies its parameter to a value and add the type constraint. But so that since we are a bit lazy, we don't want to write all that, and we really want the syntax to be as light as possible. We add some syntactic sugar, so the special optional parameter shown there. We just tell the compiler to replace the optional parameter by val of type without type and information. So that just syntactic sugar. In practice, in the current prototype, it will be a bit heavier to declare the function because of some restriction that I think may be lifted. So that's nice, but it's a bit limited just to print an integer or a float. When we want to print something more complicated, either you declare a new printer for each kind of list, or a list of integer, or float, something like that, but you don't want to do that. So we have something that allows us to compose the implicit values. So when you write toString of a list, it will find in the environment the functions that we declare. So it searches for the value. It looks at the environment and sees that there are two things declared. The string of int, if you unify that with list to string, doesn't do anything, so it doesn't match. If we try the second one, we see that it takes a list, you get out a string, so it matches. But that function requires something more, because you see that list takes a type parameter, and special function as parameter. So when we have unified string of list to list string, we see that the type parameter unified with int. Then at that point, we see that, oh, max, we have the function to match that. And we can complete the whole expression, and the compiler at the end sees that it is string of int applied to string of list applied to string of list. So that does what we want. So now the mechanism to find that is a prolog-like mechanism. It's maybe too general. We'll see if there are maybe better to choose because that may not finish. So there is no black magic hidden in that. I mean, when you write something like that, the compiler does not hide type information or values inside the function application when you don't write anything explicitly to tell him, add a parameter, a special parameter here. So if you write that stringify function, you see that the toString function here does not have any information on what will be its parameter, because stringify can be applied anywhere with any parameters. So in that case, the compiler returns to you that there is a free variable alpha, and I don't know what to do with that. So there is a way to circumvent that. It's just to tell him, well, carry by hand the information. So either way, in the first case, you take the function as parameter and add it in the local environment of the function, just in that scope, there is that function you can use. Or the implicit parameter with the optional implicit parameter, add it also to the environment automatically, so you won't have to declare it that way. So, if you want to use it in practice, you'll notice that you don't want effectively to do things exactly like that. For instance, a function matching into string may have many meanings, and you don't want the compiler to choose for you which one to use. So we need a bit more discipline to declare what, which function you want to use. And the next restriction we have, restriction that is that has a good meaning, is to only restrict the declaration of implicit to type constructors. So type constructor can be anything outside the function application or alias. So the usual one you would want to use would be records. So the nice thing with the type constructor declaration is that you give many type information at that point. So when you will use that later, you will see that when you apply F to string, you get the information of the record. So if you do that like that, you can notice that it looks quite like type classes. So what you can do easily with type classes, like declaring the class equal and num. So the class num declare a function plus, the class equal declare a function equal, and when you have a number, you know that you have equality on that. So you can do the same thing with the record corresponding, and you declare the implicit function casting a number to an equal, such that when you use a number, you can use it as an equal. So we are not restricted to records, you can do some fun thing with class and cross-class modules. So with that, you get some easy overloading thing, and you can do easily what the simple things as scalars do with dead classes. But that's not enough, because we are still too much lazy to write printers and things like that. We still want the compiler to write it for you. So when you write a big record, it's quite tedious to write the printer for that big record. And we have a type representation that can be created at runtime, at compile time, but accessed at runtime. So it's a special type. That special type can be constructed the same way as implicit values, but it's constructed in a different way. So you get int type when you ask it for int type. But that don't give you anything, but you can explore it with the add function, special function, giving you the type add constructor, which is a GLDT, that you can explore safely with its value, since it's a GLDT. You can you have the type information to explore the value at the same time. So if you can write generic function with that, for instance, the toString, you match each case of the GLDT, you do the right thing in each case. So it's nice, but it's difficult to write because, well, that's not a simple OKL. But since those are generic functions, well, you don't really need to write it yourself. There will be someone else who will be nice and write it for you. So the nice thing to do with that is doing lots of generic functions like what GenStreet does with the permit before extensions. You can do dynamic typing, since you can you have existential quantification in GLDTs, you can hide that from the exterior. So we made it such that we can go upstream at some point. So we don't ask us upstream to integrate it, but if at some time they want to, it will be easy. And that's it. So notice this is a work in progress. It will change. And there are still a lot of things to explore.
Yes, sir.